So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. It's so great to see you. So this is our ISF Ambassador annual meeting, and we had one yesterday evening. So we had 14 folks join us, and can somebody please mute? Yeah, thank you. And it was a really a great engagement last night. So we're hoping to repeat our success today. And because you know the weather is getting cooler, so I thought I have a fireside chat with Jim and Michelle to you know kind of catch up with them and understand what we have been doing in the community and with the with our members and collaborators. So Michelle, let me go to you first.
Hey,
So
morning, Jenny.
I know we had a newsletter just published, right?
Yes.
So yeah, can you please share the wonderful things in the newsletter?
Okay, absolutely. Let's and actually, in fact, I see that Zara Shasaya, sorry, is on the call from Tehran, and I wanted to call her out for her great work. This newsletter is very much a team effort. And y'all know that Cecilia Lee has been the chief content, the editor in chief of the newsletter for nearly 2 years. And then she was promoted, has a new job she's very excited about. And in June, July, said she needed to step down. And we've been working July, August, September through the third quarter to on how that transition would work. And Zara Shasaya, who joined us last spring as a volunteer, and has really helped with the process, you know, pulling in especially amplifying ambassador messages and what events, conferences, insights you've posted on LinkedIn. She's regularly pulling that in to a digest in the newsletter of upcoming events for ambassadors and for and a recommended reading list. So kudos and thank you out to Zara, who is on this call. And now this is the first newsletter in its new format, the October issue. And those are on the website under, you know, blog slash news. But just a new frame, basically, to align it to our more recent work on the website, pulling in the graphics, which are again about to change in 2024. But here's the current look. So who's eyes up? And this also good news, we're now up over 1,750 members. And so the numbers are all about to change on web and in all our communications. And we have a new community lead we'll be introducing shortly, who's pulling together some metrics and helping us better understand. But the October message, basically, so then we'll have the quick what's in this newsletter up top. And here it's our Meet Your Candidates for VP, the highlights of the Discovery Summit, the link to nominate for excellence in service innovation next year, and always advance review on upcoming ambassador events, conferences, and that recommended reading list that Zara's curated for you with Jim's help. On whittling it down, there is so much. So I see we have one of our VP candidates on the call, but here's their in the newsletter, their platforms and information about the three candidates for vice president. And the link to vote, which is this month, deadline next week. And then and always there's kind of a color code. If it's in green, it pertains to awards. So it's time to nominate the awards. The links are here. And these were the best paper awards. The Discovery Summit recap is here with on all things, trying to just have less text. Here's what's happened, and click for more. Get folks to the website where there's lots more information and links and resources. And ambassadors will always have the quick digest from Christine Oyang as to what's up and of emphasis in this month and coming months, and then key events and an ambassador spotlight. And then the always the call, get involved by contributing to this newsletter with those monthly guest articles. be an ambassador, clicking to that section of the site, the call for authors to publish a chapter or a book in that partnership, and the updated list of all our volunteer needs, which are many. And then that, I think, very impressive recommended reading list. And you'll see at the bottom, we're no longer framing it with, by the way, did you know we are free? We're not saying that right now, which is all I'll say about that. But that's the October newsletter.
And again, yeah, thank you, really Michelle. Good. Yeah, thank you. Such a rich content there. And then, of course, I know some of you have done an interview, ambassador interview, right, with Cecilia earlier this year, and then and also next last year. You know, please continue to, you know, to do that, and we're planning to, you know, continue that series. And then also, if there's a particular topic you're really you know, passionate about, you know, you can write a blog, and then we can publish the, you know, in the newsletter as well. So you know, please reach out to me and Michelle and Zara, right, to volunteer. All right, so let's move on. And Jim, I heard that we had a great event at the Discovery Summit, Tech for Good. I was able to only join very briefly, but I was able to watch the replay, and I really enjoyed listening to the speakers, the panelists, right, the keynote speaker and panelist. So could you do a recap for us?
Sure, happy to do that. And I will put in a little link to it. I know some of you were able to attend our Discovery Summit. Our, you know, you can think about iZIP as having these monthly things. We have the monthly newsletter, but once and sometimes twice a year, we have our big online event, which is called the Discovery Summit. This year, it was called Tech for Good. And we had a great lineup of speakers, as usual. Our Carlotta Arthur from the National Academy of Engineering, Science, Engineering, and Medicine. She was our keynote speaker. And for those who don't know, Carlotta leads the social and behavioral unit at the National Academy of Engineering. And I just loved it when she said, when you think about innovation, if you want to get the benefits and lessen the harms, make sure you have a diverse set of stakeholders represented as you innovate. And of course, social scientists are an important stakeholder, and so many of the problems with innovation end up in the social realm. So it was a great keynote. She made some fantastic points about technology for good. Deb Stokes, who's our vice president of iZIP this year, she'll be our president next year. She's at Dell Technology. And she did a fantastic job leading a panel. We had Vanita Wells from Meta, talked about the metaverse. And then that was followed by David Lee, from a professor at UC Santa Cruz, who leads a Tech for Good group there at UC Santa Cruz. He educates over 200 students a year that go through program doing initiatives in Tech for Good. And Michelle and I had an opportunity to go down to UC Santa Cruz one time and meet some of the outstanding students. Ray Yao from NVIDIA presented about healthcare and AI startups, and Nicole Reinecke did a fantastic presentation weaving in some of the great ideas from her compassion-driven innovation book, which is part of the iZIP BEP series. And for those who don't know Nicole, she's also one of our candidates. She, in addition to being our co-chair of our strategy council and an ambassador, is on the call, and also one of our candidates for iZIP vice president in 2024, along with two other very worthy candidates. So I'll turn it back over to you, Christine, but we do have the recording posted and the slides, and it was a great event. It's 2 hours, and part of the reason we post the recordings is we know there's people in time zones all over the world who don't get a chance to participate because of conflict, so we know everybody's very busy, but you can see the slides and the recording online, and I encourage you to do so if you haven't seen it.
Yeah, thanks, Jim. Let's go back to Michelle. And I understand we had some changes in the leadership team. Could you give us an update on that one?
Let me pull that slide up. So it's been a good year of growth for ISIP. And you'll probably remember last year, I think Rama Akiraju here had just stepped down from the board when we last met because she moved to a high level executive job at NVIDIA. So Rama has shifted over to the Strategy Council, staying very involved, as Cecilia Lee is. That's what's exciting. All the changes really in leadership are people are shifting into different roles and staying very involved. That open seat on the board, the IBM seat, is now occupied by Jeff Welzer, who's with IBM, leads the Almaden research team. And we have two new, Annie Hardy had been on Strategy Council. Annie Hardy and Warner, the Hoyer at Cisco, are new members to the board. So all three of those are new this year. And it's new too for us to show, our leadership. There's the board of directors on which Jim serves, Jim Spohr, who everyone knows and all have a connection with and a beginning of ISIP with, I think. And Jim also serves, so hence this little overlap, the executive leadership team, the active engaged leadership team, which this year, Utpal is president, as Jim mentioned, Deb Stokes is our vice president. And then already mentioned, I think, that Cecilia Lee has edited the newsletter and is now staying in her ambassador role, but stepping into a new job in her day life. So we have that opening, a chief content editor of the newsletter. So ask anyone on this call, if you have a nomination, please let me or Jim or both know. Looking to fill that
role. Not building, aren't they, mate?
Hey, Sean, you might have a mute issue. And also for that chief editor role, just, the fact that Zara is on the job pulling in such great content. It's really a job of prioritizing editing, and for now I'm the managing editor with that newsletter. The Strategy Council, we have a couple openings, and that too, ask for nominations. It's going to be meeting November 6th, and this is kind of the pipeline too, other leadership and institutional membership, but it's the Strategy Council. They'll meet November 6th and determine the topics of next year. And actually, Nicole Reinecke, who's on the call, is co-chair of that Strategy Council, along with Deb Stokes. I think those are the key changes. Jim, did I miss anything?
I think you covered it well.
Okay.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks, thanks, Michelle. Great to see these wonderful leaders, helping and actively participating, contributing to the ISIP. So I also see a lot of people today. I was just wondering, Jim, we had, with your help, found like 10 new ambassadors. So I see a couple on this call. Most of them, they were on last night's call yesterday. But maybe we can start an introduction here, and then maybe just go around the room quickly. Everybody just introduce him or herself.
We'll give everybody who's participating, it looks like we're up to 21 participants, a chance to introduce yourself. And last night, I'll just briefly mention that as I look at this great list, I don't know if you can go into full screen mode or not, Christine, but Mauricio Manjes, he was on the call last night. I don't know if he's on the call this morning. I'm quickly scrolling to see. He's one of our new ISIP ambassadors this year, who's also a candidate for Vice President 2024, President 2025. He, like many ISIP ambassadors, combines both academic and industry. That's one of the things we are very proud of at ISIP, that we have a lot of people who span both those roles. He was a professor of service design at SCAD, which is one of the top based in Georgia. Apple, for example, recruits heavily from SCAD, a lot of their user experience people, but he's also works with financial institutions and now also has a human-centered AI startup that he told us a little bit about last night. Vaishali Main was also on the call. I don't know, I'm scanning to see if Vaishali, no, she's not on, but she was on last night. She's also a new ambassador who's a VP candidate. She was at IBM way back in the day when we started our Service Science Initiative, and then went off to Google, where she also does publications on customer experience. And now she's based in Austin, Texas. Laura Anderson was also on the call. She's an IBMer from IBM Almaden Research. She's one of our new ambassadors, and she is helping to better connect us to women in engineering organizations at IEEE and other places. So those are three that were on the call last night. We also had Jay Candempoli, who was on the call last night.
Jay is here too.
Okay, so Jay will introduce himself. Yeah, right. He's with the Journal of Service Management at the Ohio State University, among other things, and I'm sure he'll fill us in more. I just want to get through the Bert Painter was on. He's a socio-technical system design leader. Kevin Clark was in, people-centered internet. So they were on the call last night. And I will turn it over since Jay is on. Jay, you can go first and introduce yourself, and we'll go around to the others who are on the call to introduce themselves as well. So Jay, over to you.
Thank you, Jim. Thanks to all of you, and great to see all of you here. My name is Jay Candempoli. Call me Jay. I'm perfectly fine with that. And I'm a professor at Ohio State University. My area of interest and expertise is in service management. I also is the editor-in-chief of Journal of Service Management. I created a program some years ago, and that's how I met Jim, in fact, called IR System. It's mainly to promote service research in developing countries. And for the last 13 years, we've been, you know, doing a lot of work, basically guiding young scholars and young PhD students as well into the idea of service research. Many countries, the idea of service research is not known at all, although service is growing in all those countries, but they have not looked into service per se as a research topic. So this initiative has really succeeded a lot, particularly because, you know, many service conferences do not go to other countries. And therefore, for people in those countries to come to Europe or North America is very, very expensive. And therefore, to getting to know, getting to the ideas about service has not been well established. And this has been very successful. So if any one of you are interested in this area of helping young scholars in developing countries into service, please do get in touch with me. I can probably send you the link to my journal as well, Journal of Service Management, and that might also help. Jim spoke as a keynote speaker when we had the conference in 2011 in Indonesia. I hope, Jim, you might remember that. So Yogyakarta and in Indonesia. So we started from Mauritius and then to Indonesia and to China and to Slovenia, Estonia, Malaysia, Thailand, India. Last year was in Poland. This year is going to be back in India. Next year is going to be in India, then back in Mauritius, and then in Turkey. So the idea is basically giving people a new perspective, because to many developing countries, the idea of service research is new. And that's the perspective. So if you would like to join up, if you'd like to contribute in any way possible, I'll highly recommend you to reach out to me, or Jim will be able to guide to me as well. So thank you so much to all of you. Jim, thank you.
Thanks, Jay. Let's see, who should we call on next, Christine?
Maybe Nicole, because she's running for vice president. So I'd like to give her some time to share her view for the future of ISIP.
Sure, I'd love that. So for those of you who haven't met me, I'm Nicole Reinecke. I was formerly Senior Distinguished Engineer at Dell. Then I was Senior Vice President of Innovation at Iron Mountain. And I am now the founder of an organization. We have our first flagship product that is in alpha right now and ready to go to market. The product that I'm developing is actually the ability to do early bias detection in product development and design. It's at journeymap.ai. And the entire philosophy around the work that I do is, how do we ensure that we do the most good in the most informed way, so that we can make really hard trade-off decisions when we need to, and that we can be transparent about those decisions. So a lot of the work that I do and what I'd love for our organization to do is to help people make more ethical, informed decisions with less bias as we go into this new era of, you know, incorporating these black box capabilities across our service and our product offerings. So that's really where my passion lies. A lot of that work can be done through education, through informed technology, and really just through conversations and through training. So that's what my priorities are. I do want to make sure that we grow the engagement of the organization. So that's a high priority for me as well.
Thank you, Nicole, for your vision and good work. Tech for good, right? And maybe we go to Zara, because she's relatively new, but she has done a ton of work helping us. So Zara, are you there?
Yes. Hello. Hello.
Yeah, we can hear you. Yeah.
Hello, it's Zara. I'm living in Tehran, and now I'm working in Tehran. It's a great honor to be in this event beside a professional. I'm working as a mentor of planet. InsurTech Hub is the famous InsurTech Hub in Tehran, in Iran. It's the first ranked InsurTech Hub in Iran. Besides that, I have a collaboration with ISIP as an communication coordinator, besides Chief Content Program Management. Since I guess it's a great pleasure to work with this great team. It's a great opportunity for me as it's I never had such experience before. And I'm really, I want to say great thanks to Michelle and Jim for this opportunity that they give to me to participate in different projects and different teams. I hope I can have a great job and great work in the near future for the ISIP and the different organizations. Thanks.
Thank you, Lara. That's great. So before we move to our next ambassador, Michelle, can you please stop sharing so that we can get everybody on the screen? Everybody turn on your camera. Let's take a picture together. Even though we're not able to, you know, meet in person, but at least virtually, let's take a picture. If you can turn on your camera. All right. So, here's Sean and Meng and Damer. All right. So, everybody smile. Oh, I like the background, Pat. All right, 1, 2, 3. All right, I got it. All right, let's go back to the meeting. Thank you, I just wanted to, you know, take a picture of all of us together. So let's move on to maybe Meng, are you there? I think you are also a relatively new ambassador, right? Can you hear us?
Who did you call on, Chris?
Meng Li.
Oh, yes, from Taiwan. So, yeah. Or hello, maybe I'm not able to join. Let's see. Meng Li. Yeah, I don't know if Meng Li can unmute or not. Maybe right, not. Oh well.
Yeah. Next. All right. So let's move to Mariana then.
Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Yes. Excellent. I have also realized I have a background with my ex-university, but yes, I hope that's not an issue, although I may be confusing everyone. So I'm currently the editor of two journals, Journal of Service Theory and Practice, which is one of the top journals in service research. I also edit a journal called Journal of Hospitality and Tourism Management. That's a top journal in the field of tourism and hospitality research. I'm at the moment in the UK, University of Sheffield Hallam, but I'm moving back to Australia where I was a few years ago. I'm going to University of Newcastle, Professor of Marketing, Director of the International Hotel School. My research area, it focuses on technologies and services, particularly in tourism and hospitality. That's why I'm heavily involved in that industry. At the moment, I'm looking at the impact of metaverse and NFTs and generative AI on service experiences, as well as on creativity, particularly for service employees. I don't know what else to say. I have been running quite a few initiatives to try to give the floor and the professional development opportunities for researchers to participate in service research. One initiative which probably you might have seen is we run an annual hackathon, a paper hackathon. The paper hackathon is sponsored by the Journal of Hospitality and Tourism Management. This is the opportunity whereby any researcher, either if it is still a doctoral student or an early career or even a mature researcher, they are invited to form teams, and we encourage people to form teams with a great mixture of people so one can learn from the other. Work quite hard, like a marathon, within the duration of 1 or 2 days, and we usually host this back-to-back with a conference, or during the last years we have done the hackathon online, specifically because of COVID, as you can imagine. So people have the opportunity for 2 days to collaborate together, come up with a research project. The journal assigns every team with a mentor to give feedback and to guide the research team. And at the end of the 2 days, me and other mature researchers, members of the editorial board, they are the judges. And our purpose is not only to give a ranking and a score, but it's also to provide constructive feedback to the team to improve the research and to continue their project. So this is one of the initiatives that we have been running quite successfully during the last, I would say, 5 years. The first time we did it, it was 2018, and we are still doing it. We also run an annual research symposium in tourism hospitality research. We have been doing that face-to-face. During the last years, because of COVID, we went online. People can find all the presentations on the YouTube channel of COTHI, and I will type the URL of the association where you can find the presentations. The presentations, they are basically videos of our keynote speakers. One of them were Professor Ray Risk. Ray Fisk,
yes. Hey, Mariana, could you put the link into the chat? We're going to try to get a few more people to introduce themselves. And I did suggest people follow you on LinkedIn because you are one of our most prolific ISIP ambassadors on LinkedIn. And I really enjoy following you. You are engaged in so many things. It is really...
So probably instead of consuming time from everyone, yes, probably link to my profile on LinkedIn and see what initiatives we are doing.
Thank you. Thank you, Mariana. And I really do encourage people to connect with Mariana on LinkedIn and follow her and just scroll through her many activities. And tourism and hospitality is such a great industry. It's really a fun one, and it touches every part of the planet. So just going around quickly, I'm going to go in the order I saw people join. So Marietta Baba, you are one of the first people to join the Zoom a little early. So could you briefly introduce yourself? And then we'll go to Steve Kwan and Clara Bassano.
Sure. Thanks, Jim. Marietta Baba. I'm an anthropologist. For the past 5 years, I've been working as the executive director of a small nonprofit called Foundation for Women and Children Enslaved in War. We have two missions. One is we support other nonprofits that are providing direct services to survivors of human trafficking. And the second thing is we conduct research on service organizations and try to understand what their challenges and needs are. So for the past 5 years, we've been looking at the whole issue of supporting survivors and how do you know if what you're doing is effective? Right now, there is no mechanism for finding out if services to survivors of human trafficking are effective. We don't know. The services are out there. They're many and diverse and complex, but are they doing any good? We simply do not know. So we're very interested in this problem and how we work with service organizations to encourage them and support them to do evaluation of the impact of their services on their clients, which gets me to the second thing that we do. We provide free of charge grant consultation to nonprofits in this field, helping them to get external grants with the goal of having those grants support evaluation for effectiveness. So we're in the midst of doing that now. Since we're only 5 years old, we're still just coming out of the startup phase. And I can't say we have a huge number of clients, but we do have some very promising work going on right now. It's quite exciting and interesting. We find that technology plays a very complex role in this whole field. The technology for good is very promising. If you want to stay in contact with survivors of human trafficking, you really need to use technology to do it. There's no other way. And so there are a few applications out there that address this need, but not very many. And unfortunately, the people that are on the side of using technology as a facilitator for their criminal activity are sort of ahead in the race of, you know, deterrent to enabler. And so we'd really like to see more of an effort put on developing tools, applications for service organizations that want to connect with their survivors.
Very good, Marietta. Thank you. And please do put a link into the chat if you get a chance. That would be great. And Steve Hi. Kwan, one of our IZIP fellows, who's also an ambassador. Could you Thank introduce you. Yourself briefly? And then we'll go to Clara.
Yeah. Thank you. So I'm a retired professor from San Jose State, and I've been spending a lot of time on working on AI standards. So I work in the ISO IEC JTC1 subcommittee 42 on artificial intelligence. So I'm an editor of a couple of technical reports. One of them is very interesting. It's called Beneficial AI Systems. And so I've been doing a lot of work on that. And I, you know, Jim is part of that discussion, and I really enjoy the work. Thank you.
Thanks for being a leader in AI standards, Steve. You're doing some great stuff. And Clara Bassano from Italy.
Hello, everybody. I'm Clara Bassano from the University of Salerno in Italy. I'm very glad to be here, and I am a fortune person, as I met Jim in 2009 in Silicon Valley, where I had a wonderful experience with him and all his research group. Actually, at the University of Salerno, I am the director of the Observatory on Parks and Protected Areas. And my main focus is to look for new governance and innovation models to better manage and to merge the service science perspective with the viable systems perspective. I am focusing on the artificial intelligence applied in several sectors, such as fashion and luxury, tourism, from creativity to innovation service systems. And of course, we are more than welcome to co-create value and to be involved. Actually, I am promoting the role of my university, my department, in the so-called third mission, which is the role that our department has to build with the external community. We have to promote dialogue with all the stakeholders, association, policymakers, citizens, enterprises. And so I'm very happy to do this work because I think that the university has an important role in as mediator of knowledge and has to connect university with the service system, ecosystem, and all the communities. So I am ambassador for ISIP since 2012, and the hope is to do better. So I will be, yes, this is a promise, and we all can do better. So finger crossed.
Thank you, Clara. And AI governance is such an important topic these days. And yeah, you were one of our first ISIP ambassadors way back in 2012 when the organization was formed. So let's go to a relatively new ambassador, Mikel from Spain, I believe, and an expert in supply chain. Please introduce yourself.
Yeah, hello, Jim. Thank you for the kind introduction. So I'm here because of Michelle Caro, a good friend of mine living in San Francisco, and also Terry Griffith, another ambassador. She's living right now in Canada. So yeah, I'm part of the board of directors of CSEMP. It's the Council of Supply Chain Management Professionals. It's a Chicago-based nonprofit organization, but we are all over the globe. I'm based in Barcelona, Europe. And in my own company, we are doing consultancy, but especially recruiting for supply chain professionals. So I'm glad to be here and understand how innovations are coming in a technological way to our function and how do we need to, let's say, understand which are the new requirements and the skills that our customers ask our candidates to have to deal with these technologies and which are the challenges that we as human beings have with this technology dealing with. So I'm glad to be here in this team. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mikel. And let's go to Matt Seaman of the Service Innovation Consortium, one of our sister organizations. Nice to see you, Matt.
It's nice seeing you. Yeah, Matt Seaman with the Consortium for Service Innovation. We're an industry think tank made up of about 70 companies focused on innovating mostly in technology support, IT service management, which has a big focus on knowledge management. And that has shifted a lot recently to how AI is going to impact knowledge management, the curation, creation, distribution of knowledge and support services and leveraging all that information. So it's great to be here and see everyone.
Fantastic. Thanks, Matt. And let's do Christine Leitner and then Ming Li. So Christine.
Hi, thanks, Jim. Thank you so much. And thanks for the invitation. Really enjoying all these interesting comments.
Yeah, met Tim many years ago within the context of the Human Side of Service Engineering Conference, and I don't remember which year it was, Jim, but we had a pleasure of working together as the co-chairs during the pandemic. So I have a sort of two hats, if you will, in the EU. That is quite common. I am working at the Austrian Ministry for Labor and Economy, it's called at the moment, in the trade policy area. And I'm working on the intersection of policies for trade and technologies. So basically also working with the OECD and the Trade Committee and in the Digital Trade Friends Group. And the second hat I'm wearing is I'm a senior advisor at the Center for Economics and Public Administration, which is a small boutique and advocacy group or network rather based in London, and with Brexit now has a branch in Vienna where we focus on public sector innovation, so very specific work on that, and finance innovation, but a strong focus on, let's say, the policy angle, EU policies and EU regulations, in particular tech regulations. So we're also looking into AI regulation and all regulations that are coming up at the EU level, which is quite a lot at the moment. So that is one of our focuses. And yeah, happy to be in the community and happy to see so many different perspectives, and looking forward to further discussions.
Thanks, Christine. And Ming Li, can you go next?
Yeah, hello everyone. You know, it's such a pleasure to be here, and thank you, Jim, for inviting me, including me. You know, it's a great honor to learn everyone's background. You know, it's great to see, especially great to see people to work on AI, because that's what I'm working on in recent years. I'm leading a lab called the Human-Centered AI Lab at the University of Houston, you know, mainly from the perspective of business, how AI would influence the business and the society, how do we improve the readiness of AI for our community. That's what I'm doing. You know, once again, thank you everyone, and you know, such great pleasure to be here.
Wonderful. Thanks, Ming Li. It's so nice to see so many of our Eyes of Ambassadors working on human-centered AI. And I think I'll go next to, let's see, Michelle Leonard in Switzerland, and then Obaina, who joined us last night. Obaina, we'll circle back to you. Michelle, if you can come off mute. There you are. Good to see you. And Michelle Leonard is another of our great ambassadors who leads a fantastic conference, the International Explorations of Service Science. So, Michelle, do you want to introduce yourself?
Yes, thank you, James. It is an honor to share this meeting with you and all these famous colleagues. I am working about the conference, and as you say, and the next conference will be held in Brno in Czech Republic. And we want to focus it about service science to promote intelligence augmentation. And you can go to the website of the conference. Thank you for Jim to put it on the discussion field. And we will try also to create a special workshop about the role of startups in the development of entities or society through service science, of course. That is our plan for the next year. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Michelle. And Obaina, good to see you again.
Well, thank you, James. Good to see you. And thanks, everyone. Nice to meet you all. My name is Obin. I'm a UX researcher with Google Cloud AI, where I focus on the development of human-centered AI, now generative AI, for enterprise organizations who are seeking to integrate AI into their business processes. And besides that, I run an organization we call Varsity Mentor, you know, where we connect university students in Africa with African professionals in the diaspora and their allies for mentorship, skills development, and career pathway guidance. And the reason we're doing that is that, you know, by 2040, Africa will have the highest number of youth, you know, between the age of 15 and 45. And the rate of unemployment is so high among university graduates. So we're trying to expose them to new technologies. And one of those technologies and subject areas we're looking into is service research. And there are opportunities for service design on the continent. And many of them, even university faculties, are not aware of this. So we work with universities, we work with these students, you know, to help them develop these skills. And I'll be happy to discuss with anyone more on more of what we're doing. And I'll leave our online website on the chat. Now, thank you all.
Robina. And Chris, I think. Is there anybody who hasn't introduced themselves? If so, speak up. I see a few people like Devor.
Yes, I have a camera issue, but I do have a microphone. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Yes, Devor, we can hear you.
Okay, good. Apologies. I'm struggling with some AV setup today. Hello, everybody. Thanks also for having me. It's a bit of a pity. You can't see me, but I can see you, and it's great to follow. So. I've also been an ambassador for quite a while, Jim, after meeting Jim also in the Valley. So I recognize a lot of points from that story earlier. So currently my main, I'm also from Europe, so a few hats, but the thing I'm almost singularly focused on now, and it's kind of hot off the press, is the Futurecraft Habitat initiative. Where we are establishing what we think will be, you know, one of the or the largest open source construction cooperative globally, where we basically bring open source digital transformation standards and also kind of nature-based solutions to the construction industry to drive down costs of kind of solutions that are climate positive. It has quite a heavy reliance and borrowing, let's say, from the field of service science, or obviously being kind of spearheaded by me. I drew a lot of inspiration, let's say, from the learnings and the academic work I have been engaged with over the last years. So we're working with a number of global partners like KPMG Global, working with their ESG practice, but also some of the largest, let's say, developers worldwide to, you know, essentially replace stone with wood in as many cases as we can and do that in a very as transparent and accessible way as possible. So essentially having machine-readable construction designs, whether they're houses or initially we're focusing on the government market. It's also kind of where I hail from. I've worked with cities all over the world for many years. So initially the focus will be on social housing and kind of a public you know, construction. So to have those designs machine-readable, ready to produce by a factory, all for free. So that, you know, we found a way to do that through the carbon accounting of the solution. But essentially, you know, going into the other sides of the market, there is a need for servitization, particularly of these kind of new solutions, precisely because of affordability. I think we are all kind of or society is at a pivot, definitely, and models are under strain.
And a lot, I think, of the learnings we've seen from, you know, kind of the B2B side of things of, you know, servicizing stuff and, you know, breaking down things, atomizing, and then, you know, making it kind of interface better with one another, you can take that into a wealth of domains, which has been a real discovery almost, and a real pleasure to see those value propositions now also find investment. And we're essentially in the middle of launching now, so I don't know how much I can or cannot say, but I think incorporation will be next month, and then end of 2024 we will be hitting the market everywhere basically, if everything goes according to plan. So yeah, very happy to continue to kind of stay engaged and learn, and also share anything we are doing. I'm certain that a lot of the service models that we're developing, both on the platform services side, you know, ranging from kind of these open source solutions to there's a satellite tracking component, and you know, it's really a technology stack that's beautiful, if I could say so myself. To, you know, the way we interact with different stakeholders, and then you know, transact on kind of the various value components which go further than just money alone. So hopefully we'll turn into this smashing use case also for a number of the more academically inclined. In any case, thanks for having me. I'm continuing to learn, listen, and really enjoy my time. Thank you.
Thank you, Defer. And back to you, Chris. I think everybody's introduced themselves now.
Yeah, thank you, Jim, and thank you, everyone. Michelle, can we go to the slide for discussion? Yeah. Thank you.
Do you have my screen?
Yeah. Yes, we can see your screen. Not this one, the slide 10.
Yeah,
page 10.
11, because I added the calendar up front.
Which yeah, that's fine. Share, but, can we do the 10?
It's up, right? Do you not see it?
It is up, but can you move up one page, please?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, this one. Yeah. Yes, so, sorry. Yeah. So it's great. Wonderful. Everyone, you know, had a chance to introduce him or herself. And we're a big community that we're, you know, driving some of these, big ideas, right? So for the generative AI, of course, it's very much in the front and center of today's emerging technology. So, I was just wondering, have you taken any, the survey for the Discovery Summit? You know, if you haven't, then please continue to do so. And I think, Jim, you mentioned you're working, a few of you are working on a white paper based on Discovery Summit, and then and the students are continuing collecting the data from the survey. So if you haven't done it, please go ahead and complete the survey. Jim, maybe I can turn it to you to show us some examples how you used ChatGPT, and then some of the pros and cons that we should be aware of.
Sure, I'm sharing my screen. Let me see. I think, you know, the main thing I wanted to do is just, you know, first of all, I'll say the good part, and then I'll say the concerns, right? So that's service innovation. You get these capabilities that allow us to give and get service better, these powerful capabilities, and there's lots of benefits that can be had if we are responsible and use these capabilities well, but there's also potential harms for a lot of stakeholders. And I think that's what differentiates our service innovation community. We don't just talk about the capability from a technology perspective. We don't just talk about the benefits from a business model perspective, as Devar was talking about, but we also talk about needed institutional arrangements and the potential harm stakeholders and harm to the environment. But let's focus for a minute on the capabilities and the benefits. When Christine and Michelle and I were saying, what do we want to ask all the ISIP ambassadors? We decided we wanted to ask for a blog post in 2024. And so I
quickly brought up ChatGPT and said, please write a bio paragraph for Christine Ouyang. And of course, a second later, I get this very nice Christine Ouyang is a dynamic and accomplished professional who's made significant contributions to the field of technology and entrepreneurship. Maybe that's a little bit of a hallucination there at the end, but she's certainly made a lot of contributions to technology as a distinguished engineer at IBM. And then I said, please suggest three topics for Christine could write about for the iZIP blog website. You can do this yourself, obviously. Get ChatGPT to create your bio and suggest three topics for iZIP blog website. It quickly, in a second, came up with these three wonderful topics. And then, of course, I said, please write a draft blog post for Christine Ouyang for iZIP in building a diverse and inclusive innovation ecosystem. And of course, a second later, we get this very nice outline. And we did the same for Michelle Carroll. Came up with some very nice ones. And last night on the call, we did another one for David Ng. And in the interest of time, since we only have four more minutes, I'm going to just stop my share and say this was just something fun that Christine and Michelle and I did as we were preparing for this iZIP ambassador meeting. But of course, you know, the Wall Street Journal said using AI to summarize an email is like using a Lamborghini to deliver pizza. It's like, you know, there's energy impacts, there's ethical considerations. Noam Chomsky just said all of these large language models are the worst property theft since Native American property theft because of all the copyright stuff. You probably saw Meta is being sued by like 40 states in the US for social harm to young people. So again, we try to be balanced. We try not to just say, oh, this is wonderful and it's all going to be good. We also include social scientists and people who are understanding how do we build institutional arrangements, like we heard from Christine Leitner and Clara Bassano and governance. We really try in the service innovation community and iZIP to bring all of these diverse perspectives together so that we can innovate, that we can get the benefits of the capabilities while mitigating the harms. So Christine, I'll stop there because I know we only have like 3 minutes left, but I hope that was what you were looking for.
Yeah, thanks, Jim. That was wonderful. Yeah, hopefully you're interested in contributing a blog next year on a topic that you're passionate about. And then, of course, you can leverage AI to be your assistant. I have to say that, you know, you will see when you ask ChatGPT to write your bio, then you will see sometimes it can be hallucinating. We will have to be the controller of the content, at least. So Michelle, can we go to a last slide? So this is one call for actions, and Michelle and Jim have mentioned several things. For example, complete the survey. That this is the ambassador survey, which is different from the Discovery Summit survey. So if you haven't done it, please go ahead and do that. And it's only five minutes, and you can watch the replay of the Discovery Summit. And also, very important, please vote for the iZIP Vice President for 2024, who will be the President for 2025. And please nominate your colleagues, yourself, right, for a iZIP Excellence in Service Innovation Award. So that's more of a, you know, corporate, you know, the enterprise, the corporate award, right? So the for organization, and of course the team as well. So so this is the latest thing that Jim and Michelle and I came up with. So the self nomination for iZIP Ambassador of the Year, because we know that all of you are doing a lot of work helping iZIP and also helping the partnering organization. So please, self-nominate so this will be a fun award for ambassadors. And then of course, you know, join the Slack and the linking. And I also posted the two links in chat that you can use the iZIP, the Zoom background that Jim, myself, and Michelle are using. And then there's Michelle provided a very nice a deck for the introduction to ISIP that you can actually use for recruiting new members and new individual members and institutional members. So thank you for joining today, and really wonderful to see all these wonderful ambassadors, and thank you for all you're doing for ISIP, and have a great day or good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks so very much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye, Jim. Bye, Steve. Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.